Made up of far more than 10,000 islands, Nusantara, the East Indian, Malayan, or Indonesian archipelago, has been known by many names over the centuries. It is home to more than 320 million people, descended from a plethora of unique ethnic groups, who speak hundreds of different dialects and languages. It is the main global producer of cinnamon, cloves, nutmeg, and so many of the things that make food taste great. Today, this region is predominantly comprised of the emerging economic powerhouse of Malaysia, and Indonesia, the fourth most populous nation on Earth, which also has the largest Muslim population in the world, as well as the absolute monarchy of Brunei, the Roman Catholic Republic of East Timor, one of two Christian nations in Southeast Asia, and the economic colossus of Singapore. This region, originally populated by Melanesian people in humanity's early prehistory, were followed by Austronesian peoples migrating into the archipelago from the north. The earliest kingdoms that we know of that developed in this region were established approximately 2,000 years ago, and by the 3rd century, there were many prosperous independent states exporting vast quantities of spices and other luxury goods, primarily north, to the Chinese dynastic empires. These early kingdoms were heavily Indianized, and were often under the influence of the Chola dynasty of southern India, and predominantly converted to Hinduism, Buddhism, sometimes combined with local religious practices. Around the year 650 AD, the kingdom of Kantoli is believed to have changed dynasties, or evolved into the Srivijaya Empire. The Srivijayans were master seafarers whose merchant ships were a common sight from the Philippine archipelago, the Bay of Bengal, the West African coast, Arabia, and Madagascar, where many Srivijayans migrated to, where their Malayan DNA is prevalent among the modern Malagasy people 1200 years later. The Srivijayan dynasty on Sumatra would merge with the Buddhist Shailendra dynasty of Java, who would rule the empire. They embarked upon many great projects, including Borobudur, the largest Buddhist structure on Earth. By the early 11th century, Shailendra had taken Srivijaya to its greatest extent, conquering the majority of the neighboring Javanese kingdoms, thus controlling both the major trading straits of Malacca and Sunda. They took advantage of the situation and greatly increased the tax on merchant ships traveling through the straits. This not only angered the Chinese Song dynasty, who had supported the Srivijayan conquest of Java, but also their longtime trading partner, the Hindu Chola Empire of southern India. Under the pretext of aiding their fellow Hindus in the Khmer Empire and Srivijayan vassal states, the Chola Empire sent what many believe to be the largest fleet in Indian history to systematically sack the Srivijayan cities and defeat their armies. This military action had three effects. 1. The tariffs were drastically reduced. 2. The Srivijayans and the Chola were allies again, and in 1068 the Chola would send fleets of warships to aid the Srivijayans. 3. This undoubtedly sent the empire into rapid decay and decline, and by the mid-12th century, they had completely lost influence in Java, which came under the rule of the Kediri Kingdom, who began to challenge the declining Srivijayan Empire for the position as regional hegemon. The Kediri were overthrown by the legendary Kenarok, who arose from humble peasant beginnings, raised by a thief, and through a series of adventures established the Raj Asa dynasty. The rulers of Singhasari and later Majapahit empires would trace their lineages back to the mysterious figure of Kenarok. Singhasari would be extremely successful, especially under their most ambitious and last king, Kirtanagara. A flood of conquered vassals sent emissaries to the most powerful man in the world, the Mongol emperor of the Yuan dynasty, Kublai Khan, grandson of Genghis Khan. Upon hearing of this rapidly growing empire to the south, he sent emissaries asking for tribute. The first ones went ignored, and then Kirtanagara had one tattooed and his ears cut off and sent back to Kublai Khan. He was enraged and began preparing for a fleet of 1,000 war junks manned by 20,000 men to invade. This blatant act of hostility demonstrates how powerful Kirtanagara felt he really was. Unfortunately for Kirtanagara, Kublai Khan wasn't the only enemy he had made. And while the Mongol fleet was making preparations, he was overthrown by a Kediri vassal, Jaya Katwang. And when the Mongols arrived, the revived Kediri were pleased to let him know that Kirtanagara was history. The Mongols must have felt that they had sailed all that way for nothing. And then something strange happened. The son-in-law of Kirtanagara, who had his own troops and was holding out against the Kediri, convinced the Mongols to join forces with him and topple the Kediri, and restore the Singhasari Empire that they had set sail to destroy. The Mongols agreed, and utterly destroyed the Kediri Kingdom, most likely hoping to install a grateful leader who would be indebted to them. After many of his Mongol allies died in battle, or had succumbed to tropical diseases, Radhan Vijaya turned his growing army on the Mongols and annihilated them. This revived Singhasari would be known as the Majapahit Empire. The Majapahit Empire would reach its height in the 1390s and receive tribute from 98 vassal kingdoms. Around the year 1400, the Sunni Islamic Malay Sultanate of Malacca would break off from the empire and begin to gain dominance over the Malacca Straits that bears their name to this day. Shortly after the Malacca Sultanate was established, many smaller kingdoms converted to Sunni Islam, including the Kingdom of Brunei, which established a large empire that stretched as far north as the Kingdom of Tondo in the Philippine archipelago. As the Malacca Sultanate was still expanding and had become fabulously wealthy, the Portuguese arrived, and after being refused trade based on unfavorable reports of the Portuguese from Indian Muslims, the Portuguese returned 3 years later and sacked Malacca. With a fleet of Portuguese troops and Hindu-Indian mercenaries, the conquest of Malacca so enraged the Chinese emperor that he ordered all property from Portuguese merchants in China to be confiscated, and two Portuguese fleets were attacked and defeated by the Chinese in the years following the fall of Malacca. The Majapahit Empire fought a brutal civil war that left itself vulnerable to the Islamic Demak Sultanate, which overthrew the last Hindu Raja in 1527. The short-lived Sultan of Demak played a pivotal role in the Islamization of Java and Sumatra. Many Hindus chose to migrate into the heavily forested mountains, where many of their descendants still live today, and the Hindu island kingdom of Bali. Over the course of the 16th century, the Portuguese occupied several more islands to the east of Malacca. A multitude of sultanates were established in the previous realms of the Majapahit, Malacca, and Brunei. In 1641, the Dutch captured Malacca from the Portuguese. And by 1750, the Dutch had slowly become the hegemon throughout the region. Many initially welcomed the Dutch East India Company, who in contrast to the Portuguese did not push conversion to Catholicism or any other religion. They were only interested in the spice trade. However, widespread resentment slowly grew against the Dutch, who used violence to enforce stringent and often exploitative trade contract stipulations. In 1800, the Dutch East India Company was dissolved, and the Dutch East Indies was established as a nationalized colony of the Dutch. It was not until the late 19th and early 20th century that the Dutch control was able to spread beyond the fortresses and port cities to most of the land now encompassing modern-day Indonesia, while the British controlled the area that is now Malaysia. During World War II, the entire region fell under the control of Imperial Japan, where millions died from forced labor and starvation. Following the end of the Second World War, Indonesia declared its independence. The Dutch promptly invaded. This brutal war was brought to an end in 1949 as the Dutch succumbed to international condemnation and left the archipelago. The declining British Empire, unable to effectively manage its empire after the war, succumbed to the Malayan independence movement in 1957. By 1963, the Federation of Malaya combined with the former British colonies of North Borneo, Sarawak, and Singapore, forming Malaysia. Singapore would separate from Malaysia, becoming fully independent 2 years later in 1965. East Timor would declare its independence from Portugal in 1975 and was annexed by Malaysia the following year. Its independence would be restored in 2002 after many decades of bloody conflict. Brunei gained its independence from Great Britain on January 1st, 1984. This has been Epimetheus. I hope you enjoyed this brief overview of this fascinating region's complex history. This has probably been my most requested topic to date, and I hope I did this history justice and pronounced things adequately. Huge thanks to my patrons who helped me out with the cost of running this channel. I am the writer, researcher, artist, editor, and narrator, so anything you can do to help me out is greatly appreciated. If you can't write now, that's alright. Just smash the like button, subscribe, comment below, and share with your friends. That's what keeps the channel growing.